to all the dignitaries and dear students present here. A very warm welcome to you all on this platform. Today, we have a true lawyer in front of us who is the embodiment of true values of giving back to the society. She has a glorious past as a tall standing advocate who has helped the society with number of pro bono cases before entering into commercial litigation. She sits on multiple panels ranging from government, public sector units and universities. Having specialized in service sectors, she has represented many armed forces personnel of Army, Navy and Air Force before various constitutional courts and armed forces tribunals. With her values, knowledge and confidence, she represents miscellaneous matters across various service areas of law at Supreme Court of India since 2007. Her presence today will be a great value add to all of us, because not just as a lawyer, but as a noble human being full of rich experiences, she is a complete package in herself. We are really honored to have your gracious presence, ma'am.
As we all know that the topic of today's discussion, Neela ji, namaskar. Morning. I am able to see you now, right? So the topic chosen is fate of Indian judiciary in the present circumstances. The topic itself indicates certain issues, certain queries and certain considerations, that what are the circumstances which are compelling us to discuss this topic today, this issue today. Neela ji has been practicing in Supreme Court and has already handled many cases. I'm happy to see that she's really, you know, doing a lot for the cause. Recently, in a case of a student in an equivalence matter, equivalence of the degree. So she was literally, you know, pursuing, and finally she got it. A girl, her name was, Diksha or something. So she was pursuing that case. Finally, she could make it. So she is a very visionary person, very keen learner, and very, very supporting a legal person in all fields and purposes. So this is an occasion. Neela ji, this is our university. It's a state university.
Yes.
State University of Law. And this is, you know, as you know, that there are various law schools in the country, national law schools. But besides that, there are only four states now. First is Tamil Nadu, then Karnataka, then this Rajasthan State Law University, Dr. Bhimrao Ambedkar Law University. And now fourth is going to be the Odisha, having the affiliation of all the law colleges of the state with this university. You may know, you may be aware that there are certain state technical universities, certain state medical universities, and all the medical colleges of that particular state are affiliated with that medical university. So similarly, the university, Dr. Bhimrao Ambedkar Law University, Jaipur, has dual responsibility. One, to undertake various academic programs as its residential activity of the university. And we have started LLM 1-year program from the session 2021. But besides this, to administer academically to all these law colleges of the state of Rajasthan, there are 80 odd law colleges in the state, and the enrollment of the students, then examination of the students, assessment of the examination, declaration of the result, and finally awarding the degree for all those students who are pursuing their law programs in these law colleges. Degree awarded by this university is the task ahead. And though we have very rough time, difficult time, but even then we have tried to do whatever was possible. And because of this present scenario, it is little slow, but we are still working. And today your presence as a very luminary legal professional will give insight to our students and teachers and to all of us. So my utmost gratitude to you for being here. And with this, I'll request you to kindly make your viewpoint, make your presentation. And if you kindly allow, we'll request the teachers and the students mainly to make their observations at the end, so that you are able to clarify their anxieties, their concerns, because they are the future lawyers, they are the future jurists, judges. So they should also have close discussion on all such issues. With this, thank you very much. Namaskar.
Thank you, sir. Maybe now have Madam Neela Gokhale to share her views on today's topic, fate of Indian judiciary in present circumstances.
Yes, good morning, everybody, especially the learned vice chancellor and all the faculty members and all my dear students. First of all, let me thank you, sir, for saying such kind words about me. I don't think I deserve such a great acknowledgement and recognition from you. You are yourself par excellence in your own right. So having said that, I request permission to commence my few words on the topic. Before we start the discussion, I was just going through the website of your university, sir, and let me take this opportunity to congratulate the university and all of you celebrating the second year of the foundation of this university, which is on its journey in pursuit of excellence. I read the mission statement. Under the able leadership of course, your vice chancellor and all the faculty members and all the principals of the law colleges supporting the university. I must thank you for the opportunity you have given me to address your students and share my thoughts on the subject with them. As we are all aware, let's, without much ado, I'll just begin the discussion. As we are all aware, the doctrine of separation of powers of the three organs of the state is part of the basic structure of the Constitution. Article 50 of the Constitution puts an obligation upon the state to separate the judiciary from the executive. This doctrine actually emphasizes the mutual exclusiveness of the three organs. And the rationale behind this is that concentration of powers of the power in one hand leads to tyranny. To get a conceptual clarity on this, we must start at the beginning. So let us start by understanding what the parliament actually represents collectively and as an individually as a member of parliament. The task of a member of parliament is basically to represent the people of his constituency who have elected him, thereby indicating their faith, which is reposed in him, to bring to the house their grievances, difficulties, requirements, and further other things for discussion and deliberation to the platform of the house, irrespective of the political party and the ideology which has backed him. Now, bearing this in mind, the next step is to understand the concept of parliamentary democracy as the basic structure of the Constitution. Now, why I am explaining this in a very short few lines is that this is very necessary to understand the independence of the judiciary. How these two organs of the state actually interact, the interplay between these two organs, and despite all this, and in spite all this, how the judiciary has been entrusted with the task of first maintaining its independence, and second, the maintaining its transparency. So bearing this in mind, the next step is to understand the concept of parliamentary democracy as the basic structure of the Indian Constitution. The elected government, as we all know, represents the will of the people. That's the will of the sovereign. The prime minister in a parliamentary democracy is the most accountable institution. The leader of the opposition, on the other hand, is an essential aspect of that basic structure, representing the alternate voice in the parliament. The law minister, on the other hand, represents a key basic structure of the constitution, with the Council of Ministers, who are also accountable to the parliament. Thus, the parliamentary sovereignty, an elected government, the prime minister, the leader of the opposition, the law minister, and each MP represents the will of the people who in the first place have put these people, put these representatives in the parliament. Now, after the tenure of a government is over, if the representatives wish to be elected again, they must have delivered on their promises to the electorate. Otherwise, nobody is going to elect them back. In short, they have to be popular with the electorate. Now, in order to maintain this popularity, the government or these elected people will generally endeavor to pass legislature or act in accordance with things which have the popular support of the people who have elected it. However, we all know that what is popular is not what is always right. Laws may be passed in order to gain popularity or to, you know, appease to the popular mindset of the people, or what the desire of the majority. It's a majoritarian appeasement sort of thing. Okay, so this is where, despite the laws being passed with such popular support, they may not pass the test on the touchstone of the constitution always. Now, this is where the judiciary comes in. The judiciary, as an independent organ of the state, has the power, no, not the power, the duty to strike down any law passed by the legislature if it is unconstitutional or arbitrary. And in fact, the Supreme Court has been vested with the jurisdiction to declare unconstitutional executive actions as void. Such a vast power to the constitutional courts. So despite this clear demarcation of exercise of powers, which is there in the constitution itself, each institution in its own right seeks to establish primacy over the other, and that is where the friction begins. Everybody in power wants to have that little power, little extra power to exercise. Now, history is replete with instances where the strife between these institutions is apparent and the doctrine of separation has been put in jeopardy. The independence largely depends upon the manner of appointment. Obviously, whoever appoints you is going to have something, you know, some sort of a power or some sort of a authority over you. And that's the natural, the way natural things happen. So the independence of any institution, I repeat, largely depends upon the manner of appointment of its members. Let us take a quick look over the shoulder. About over 40 years ago, the first blow to the independence of the judiciary came in 1973 with the supersession of three senior most judges of the Supreme Court because they had ruled against the government of the day. 2 years later, the setting aside of Madam Indira Gandhi's election by the Allahabad High Court eventually led to the emergency and a large number of political opponents being detained without any trial in the most infamous Maintenance of Internal Security Act 1975, which is commonly known as the MISA. Now, several High Court judges struck down these orders. 16 of them were transferred without their consent, and you would be surprised to know that the names of 40 more judges to be transferred were leaked, clearly indicating that any adverse ruling would not be tolerated. What was this? A violation of the independence, an attempt to take the power, to seize the power of the judiciary by the government. However, on April 28, 1976, in the famous ADM Jabalpur case, the Supreme Court held that during the emergency, no detention could be challenged in any high court, even if it was malafide and illegal. We all know Justice H.R. Khanna, the tall figure who dissented from this much criticized majority view, but he paid the heavy price of being denied the office of the Chief Justice of India. And he was superseded by Justice M.H. Baig. For thousands of persons who were detained, the door to judicial relief was closed. They remained in jail without a trial till the emergency was finally lifted in 1977. Thereafter, the 42nd Amendment to the Constitution was passed. In addition to damaging the judiciary, the 42nd Amendment drastically cut down the powers of the High Court and the Supreme Court. As in the words of Justice, the eminent jurist H.M. Sirvai, and I quote, this was outrageous, but mercifully, Ms. Gandhi was voted out in 1977 and the new Janata government undid most of the constitutional damage. Now from 1977 to 1980, the Supreme Court partly reclaimed its prestige by a series of landmark decisions. In 1980, however, the government came back to power and the assault on independence of the judiciary was renewed. Now, how was this renewed? There was a controversial letter written by the government itself requiring as a condition of appointment, the consent of newly appointed judges to be transferred to other high courts. The transfer policy was unfortunately upheld in the S.P. Gupta versus Union of India case, which is popularly known as the first judge's case, which granted the exclusive and final say of appointment of judicial judges to the government. Now, alarmed at this executive interference, which is obviously an interference, nothing less, the Supreme Court then devised a collegium system in 1993, giving to itself the primacy and the final say in the appointment of the Constitutional Court judges. The government at the center and that of the state also had important consultative roles because, as the Supreme Court noticed, it would often be aware of certain antecedents or information relating to the individuals to be appointed, which may require a particular recommendation to be considered. This process enabled the executive to raise their objections and require the collegium to reconsider the name of a particular candidate. However, if the collegium reiterated its recommendation, the candidate had to be appointed without a demur. So this was a tussle between the two organs of the state in the matter of appointments of judges. Now, obviously the constitutional courts felt that this was a power which is vested in them. And the government obviously felt that this has to be retained, the primacy of this power has to be retained with the government so that they would have some sort of a say in the working of the other organ of the state. This was like trampling of each other's rights and, you know, stepping on each other's toes. But this was not going to be achieved by doing that. Ultimately, what a government seeks to achieve or what the constitution seeks to achieve is a harmony, is a complete harmony and working of all three organs in their own, within their own rights, and so that the administration is smooth. So this, however, if the collegium reiterated the objections, then the candidate had to be appointed without any demur from the, without any objection from the government. So this method continued until the 99th amendment to the constitution, when the National Judicial Appointments Commission Act was passed, the NJAC Act commonly known as, to substitute the collegium. Now this was a statute passed by the parliament. So there was no necessity of interpreting the provisions of the constitution as to who has the primacy to appoint the judges. As luck would have it, the NJC Act was challenged and it has been held to be unconstitutional ultimately, and the collegium system has been restored. No doubt the collegium system has been restored, but the tussle continues. Despite all this in their backyard, the constitutional courts, however, continue to discharge their constitutional functions exemplarily, without fear or favor, is the stated motive. Now, there is a long line of landmark decisions given by the constitutional courts, which reflect the judicious intent to do justice. That is a no mean feat. And many a times, as we all know, the institution has been highly criticized for faltering at times, to the extent of facing allegations of catering to government desires, upholding a particular act constitutional in return for post-retirement favors. The most recent example is that of Justice Gogoi, when everybody, so many people, there was such wide-scale criticism that immediately after his retirement, he was appointed as a Rajya Sabha member. And then all his judgments were, you know, criticized and looked at with a magnifying glass. So they have to bear that kind of criticism. But in the end, the institution has come through with flying colors, always asserting and reasserting its independence, always rising to the occasion, which requires its protection. Now, with this background, let me just discuss some important decisions of the Supreme Court, which are a hallmark of its robust and vibrant role as the guardian of the Constitution. I just want to discuss with you all these cases. It was a very hard time deciding which cases to discuss with you and no, because there is a long line. It's a never-ending exercise, you know, to read all these judgments, analyze them, and actually try and understand what is it that makes the judiciary tick? What is it that, the responsibility which they have to discharge to maintain, retain transparency, maintain its independence, and actually stand up to what they are supposed to do by the Constitution. We can start with the Shah Bano case. We have all heard, I'm sure as law students, you've all read the Shah Bano case. In 1978, April, a 62-year-old Muslim woman, Shah Bano, filed a petition in the court demanding maintenance from her divorced husband, Muhammad Ahmed Khan. He was a renowned lawyer in Indore, Madhya Pradesh. Muhammad Khan had granted her an irrevocable talaq. And later in November, the two were basically married in the year 1932, had five children. Shah Bano had actually given up her life, entire years of her life in toiling for her husband, her children, as I'm sure every, even in this day and age, women are supposed to do. And after three sons and two daughters, Shah Bano's husband asked her to move to a separate residence 3 years before, after a prolonged period of her living with him and his second wife. So she had to endure living with his second wife, looking after his five children, looking after both of them. And ultimately, after having done so much, she was kicked out of the house. What was she to do? She went to court seeking maintenance under the provisions of the secular law. Which was the secular law? The provision of 125 CRPC. Now she was granted the same, obviously, which the husband challenged in the Supreme Court. Now, what was his stand? He said that this law was not applicable to them. This law was not applicable to divorced women under the Muslim religion. Now the Supreme Court, after hearing detailed arguments from the parties and other interveners, including the All India Muslim Personal Law Board. Now understand this, there was so much of resistance to this issue that most of the community members of this religion did not want the secular law, that is the 125 CRPC provision, to apply to its women. The 5-judge bench of the Supreme Court ultimately held that the judgment of the High Court was correct and declared that even a divorced Muslim woman was entitled to seek remedy under the secular provision of 125. As you have it, there was a huge uproar following this Shah Bano judgment, which made the government in power of that day introduce and later enact a new law. Obviously, like I said, what was popular, what was not always right. But to cater to the popularity, to appease to the popular opinion of the people, the government was left with no alternative but to pass this law. This law, namely the Muslim Women Protection of Rights of Divorce on Divorce Act, came into effect. Now, essentially and conceptually, this law was, the endeavor of passing this enactment was to actually take away what the Supreme Court has given. This act provides that a divorced woman shall be entitled to have from her husband a reasonable and fair maintenance, which is to be made and paid to her within the iddat period. Nothing, no problem with that. But then what was tried to be interpreted was that the husband would maintain the wife under this law only till the iddat period was over. That is the 3 menstrual cycles after the divorce. But the section 125 CRPC contemplated that maintenance to be given to a wife, including a divorced wife, even after the iddat period, till she remarries or till she dies, or she makes herself ineligible to receive that maintenance in any other which way as per the provisions of the act. So essentially the relief given by the Supreme Court to Muslim women and to bring them on a similar footing as women of other religion was taken away by the popular government. Interestingly, the constitutionality of this act was also challenged by the Supreme Court, which was in that Daniel Lateef versus Union of India case. And ultimately, though the petition itself was rejected and the act was upheld, but the Supreme Court clarified the interpretation of this act. The Supreme Court said that wherever the wife was able to maintain herself after the iddat period, fine, no issue. But if at any stage the divorced woman, the divorced Muslim wife, was not able to maintain herself without any assistance of the husband, then she is entitled to claim maintenance under the secular provisions of the 125 CRPC provision. So this is where the Supreme Court actually stepped in, and despite the fact that the government of the day gave in to the popular appeasement, regular politics, and enacted that law, the effect of that law was brought in line with the provision of Section 125 CRPC. This is one very important case which journey begins to understand where independence of the judiciary has been maintained and after a long struggle. There is a long line of landmark judgments, like I said, which clearly indicate the independence of the judiciary in face of many attempts to gain primacy in the democratic setup. Another example of the judicial intent is in the case of D.K. Basu versus State of Bengal. I'm sure all of you have read this case, but just in a nutshell, the Supreme Court in this case laid down specific guidelines required to be followed while making arrests. A letter, a simple letter from the executive chairman of the Legal Aid Services, West Bengal, was converted into a PIL, that's a public interest litigation, by the Supreme Court in February 1987. We all know Justice D.K. Basu, retired Justice Daku, recently passed away, and a really commendable person. A letter from the retired justice was converted into a public interest litigation, and during the course of proceedings, the court also received various other letters. In fact, they received a letter from Ashok Kumar Jhori, drawing the attention of the court to the death of one Mahesh Bihari of Pilkhana, Aligarh, in police custody. The court included all these letters in this PIL and took up the issue, being cognizant of the allegations of the ever-increasing frequency of deaths in custody, described generally by newspapers as lock-up deaths. They were put in the category of lock-up deaths, custodial deaths. At that time, and even now, I think, but more at that time, there was no machinery to effectively deal with such allegations. Since this was an all-India question concerning most of the states, notices were issued by the Supreme Court to all the states calling upon them to give their opinion and their comments on this issue. Ultimately, guidelines were laid down as mandates, and this case is still pending. There are interim guidelines laid down by the Supreme Court, but then the police reforms as such have not actually been effected by the government. In fact, there's a lot to be done, and so many things have to be done to ensure the transparency and ensure the administrative abilities of the police reforms, police forces in the country. But the Supreme Court has tried to do its bit, and the case is still pending final adjudication. Similarly, in cases like in reference to, there are two motor cases, inhuman conditions in 1932 prisons, where while considering the issue of unnatural deaths in prisons, the court issued extensive directions for training and sensitization of prison officials, appointment of counselors for prisoners, conducting a performance audit of prisons, exploring the idea of open jails and open prisons, and to account for the number of unnatural deaths of children in conflict with law in childcare institutions. This was a very, very important judgment. This is very important guidelines, which perhaps have yet not been implemented. In fact, recently, in recent times, you may have read in the newspapers, the Supreme Court has also laid down that house arrest is also legal. You know, because in these COVID times, where there is an overburden and congestion in most of the prisons, wherever the prisoners have been let on parole, and if at all it is felt by a particular government or a particular constitutional court that a particular prisoner cannot be let free, then he can be even placed under house arrest. And that period of house arrest cannot be, you know, has to be calculated in his stay in the prison itself. So this was a very, a very public-based, a very environment and the need of the hour-based judgment, which the Supreme Court has very recently given. Now, coming to recent times, I had the opportunity to render assistance in a suo motu case taken up by the Supreme Court, which is referred to as an alarming rise in cases relating to sexual harassment of children. It was a suo motu case when the Supreme Court was really shocked by the number of cases of child harassment, sexual harassment of children. Now, the Supreme Court being concerned about this increase and lack of access to effective legal machinery issued various directions, including establishment of POXO courts and special exclusive courts to try cases relating to these POXO offenses. It has been directed that in every judicial district, wherever there are more than 100 FIRs relating to POXO offenses, there would be at least one exclusive POXO court. Although the act was notified, but as you would have it, as we all know what happens, The rules were not notified. There's a lot of inadequacies in the act itself, which was going to be supplemented and complemented by the rules, which were to be framed under the act. And the dogged determination and persuasion of the Supreme Court, believe me, actually, we had dates every week. And every week, the Supreme Court was hearing each state, you know, alphabetically order. What has this state done? How many POXO courts you have established? What are the funds released to you? Have you provided the utilization certificate? You know, this every week to week hearings were taking place. I was part of the hearing. I was representing the Union of India. And this persuasion of the Supreme Court finally ensured that POXO rules of 2020 were framed and notified. These rules have now been notified, and specific provisions regarding interim compensation to rape victims and so many other important and detailed provisions have been made in this rule. It is not as if the government has shrugged away its duties. They have also risen to the occasion and have in appreciation of the court's persuasion have timely framed these guidelines. Another case is that of the woman in uniform. And I'm very proud to say that. I was also part of that case representing the union. And unfortunately, I was actually resisting this, resisting and defending the stand of the government, wherein women in the armed forces got a shot in the arm as their fight for equality in the armed forces met with the support of the Supreme Court. Initially, there were only men who could get permanent commission in the armed forces. There's only men officers who could be permanently commissioned in the Army, Navy, and the Air Force. And the women always got commissioned, but they were only, the period of tenure of service was only restricted to 5 years, which could be extended by a further period of 5 years and a further period of 4 years, and thereafter they had to retire. So they were not given, you know, they were not given a permanent commission, and at the age of, say, 40, they had to go home. And what would they do after that? Right? So this was what, and this was a complete discriminatory stand taken by the Union of India, especially the armed forces. Now their right to have permanent commission was upheld, and the government was directed to consider them for permanent commission on the same footing as the men officers. This was that Bita Punia versus Union of India case, where so many women officers were given a reprieve and were held to be entitled and eligible to be considered in all stream of the forces on the same footing as their male counterparts. In fact, despite this order, while considering these women officers, while implementing this order, it's still not been implemented completely because obviously the MOD tries to find a loophole somewhere and say that the medical category, the person that they are not fulfilling the medical categories. Now the medical category which was fixed was that of a man officer, men officers. Now, how would women officers at the age of 45, when they have been directed to be considered now, they will definitely not fulfill. Now, the Supreme Court actually diluted the stand of the government of India and said, no, medical criteria has to be as if they were on the date, as if they were entitled, on the date of which they were entitled to be considered back then, when they were actually retired or told that you will not be getting permanent commission. So this was a very landmark case. Justice Chandrachud, we all know, he's been very progressive and giving a lot of good judgments. Another case worth mentioning is that of Visakha versus Union of India. Now in 1997, India's women celebrated a landmark moment, and when the Supreme Court formulated the Visakha guidelines that made it mandatory of institutions across the country to put in place measures to prevent and redress sexual harassment in the workplace. The movement basically that pushed for these mechanisms has its origin in the sexual harassment and gang rape of Bhavri Devi, a woman employed by the Rajasthan government's women's development program, which is as a sati, as workers in the program were called. It was Devi's job to spread awareness about hygiene, family planning, and necessity of educating girls, along with campaigning against female infanticide, dowry, and child marriages. Now, harassed in the course of work, she was raped by 5 Gujar men as punishment in 1992 for stopping the wedding of a 9-month-old Gujar girl, a 9-month-old girl who was getting married. A nationwide network of women's organizations decided to support Bhavri Devi's fight for injustice. Led by groups in Rajasthan, the movement recognized that Devi was attacked at what was essentially her workplace. In the absence of a law that tackled such harassment, four women's organizations filed a writ petition in the Supreme Court, asking for guidelines that would help institutions recognize, prevent, and redress sexual harassment in the workplace. These groups were Visakha and Women's Rehabilitation Group from Rajasthan and Jagori, and Kali for Women from Delhi. The Visakha guidelines thereafter laid the foundation for the Sexual Harassment of Women at Workplace Act 2013. But yet again, sadly, it was only 7 years after these guidelines were passed and laid down by the Supreme Court that the Parliament ultimately passed the Act. Nevertheless, the Act is enforced now and it is very well implemented. This conflict between the judiciary and the state can also be viewed in the Sabarimala case. The Sabarimala judgment greased the wheels of social integration and breathed life into the feminist jurisprudence. The petitioners had asserted that regressive interpretation of scriptures could not be used for prolonging discriminatory practices based on the biological state of a person. They said that women from 9 to 90 were not entitled to go into this temple. Why? Because they said, as per the scriptures, the god, the deity which was in the temple was a brahmachari, and he would not, it was not permitted for women of menstrual age to worship this deity. This litigation has been a quest for judicial intervention to restrict dogmatic practices in the alleged pursuit of religion. Denying women entry into places of public worship solely on the basis of the physiological state is not the mandate of the Indian Constitution and transgresses the spirit of right to equality under Article 14. This was a cause taken up by the Indian Young Lawyers Association. And in 2018, the Constitution Bench allowed the entry of women, irrespective of age, into the Sabarimala temple on the ground that the ban violated the fundamental right of freedom of religion as per Article 25 of the Constitution. The provision restricting entry of women in the state legislation was struck down and deemed unconstitutional. Through this judgment, the court asserted that it is a keeper of constitutional conscience and shall not be herded by circumstantial duress or popular morality. This is where I'm sorry to repeat, but this is what I mean when popularity is what drives the force to legislate or pass orders as far as the executive is concerned, because they want to be popular with the masses. But judiciary has its own role to play. Judiciary cannot be waived. Judiciary cannot be swayed by the opinion of a majority, and it has to balance the views of the majority as well as what is correct and right and within the four corners of the Constitution. But alas, the curtains have not fallen on this case yet, as a review petition filed by the state is pending adjudication and has been directed to be considered by a 7-judge Constitution Bench. The decision, in addition to this, the decision to legitimize diversity of sexual orientation among consenting adults in the case of Navtej Singh Johar versus Union of India, there's also been a disruptive and progressive approach adopted by the Supreme Court. We all know that the Indian Penal Code in 377 had criminalized consensual relationship between two adults of the same sex. This contentious issue of homosexuality was loathed and frowned upon unanimously by all religious communities in India, and they vehemently opposed the petitioners in their endeavor towards securing justice for the lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, and the LGBTQ community. By holding that the LGBTQ community is entitled to equal protection before the law under Article 14, the Supreme Court expanded the inclusiveness into the legislative and social fabric of India. I remember I was in the court that day when the judgment was pronounced, and Justice Deepak Mishra, who was the Chief Justice and the presiding officer of the Constitutional Bench, he first pronounced it, and his first line was, "I am as I am, and take me as I am." This was the line which has been etched in the memory and the history of this judgment, which starts with this line And in fact, it was a tremendous moment of victory for all these people and the petitioners. And of course, it is actually a victory for all the discrimination which has been happening throughout decades in our country and within and despite our constitution. So this ultimately, by striking down this Section 377 of the Indian Penal Code as unconstitutional, the court also asserted that public or religious morality would not override individual autonomy. This verdict too has expanded the scope of Article 14 and 21 and reaffirmed the ideals of pluralistic and inclusive society. You may know a recent development is that in the Delhi High Court, a petition has been filed and it's pending. In fact, it's here. It's to be listed in the end of May for final hearing. Marriages between same sex need to be legalized. So that is the prayer of the petitioners. What will happen? It's ultimately what the judges decide, and it's the fate remains to be seen. Again, only recently I was appearing for a trust, where in the wake of the unfortunate demise of Sushant Singh Rajput, we all must have seen on television this case and whatever was happening with this investigation, the popular Bollywood actor. The media had apparently gone overboard with constant bombarding of information regarding the alleged suicide and investigation by the Bombay police. Now, potential witnesses were interviewed by the media, autopsy reports were flashed, doctors were interviewed, so on and so forth. By the time the matter came to trial, I'm sure the entire evidence would be diluted. Several petitions came to be filed in the Mumbai High Court, seeking regulation on the media by government action. What most of the petitions prayed, there were three petitions, mine was the fourth. Three petitions said that the direction should be issued to the government to give regulations and to put restrictions on the media. Now, I had the opportunity to appear for one of the petitioners. It's our own trust called In Pursuit of Justice. And the issue in our matter was that we said that the regulation of government, of media by the government would be a counterproductive thing, because this would lead to disastrous consequences. You know, you put restrictions in the media. You tell the media, you are supposed to do this. And then, you know, it's this government or the next government or the very next government, whichever government is in power, is going to have control over the media, which is actually the fourth pillar of democracy. What we said was, our suggestion was that the Lakshman Rekha should be drawn by the courts by invoking the Contempt of Courts Act, whereby any publication or broadcast, if it has the effect of actually obstructing the course of administration of justice, shall be held to be contempt of court. And it squarely falls within the definition of contempt of court as given in the Contempt of Courts Act. The Bombay High Court once again rose to the occasion and has laid down elaborate guidelines. And I'm proud to say that the Bombay High Court has actually rejected, has not given any direction that the government will regulate the media. But elaborate guidelines have been laid down for the regulation or for the working of the media. Now, another example of the progressive and transformative approach of the constitutional courts is in adoption laws. It's a different topic, but it's also important. It is because of the activist approach of the Supreme Court way back in 1984, in the case of one Lakshmikant Pandey, who petitioned the Supreme Court in the PIL, seeking regulation of adoption cases in the country. This led to establishment of CARA. You know, there's a CARA, there's a Center of Adoption and Resource Agency, which is under the Ministry of Women and Child Development, which regulates the adoption, whatever adoptions, institutional adoptions, which happen in the country. Not only domestic adoptions, but children who are placed in international families, through international adoption, in foreign families through international adoption. This is yet another direction given by the constitutional courts to curb practices of trafficking of children under the guise of adoption. The Supreme Court has also come to the rescue of armed forces when there was no effective mechanism to ensure voting rights for the members of armed forces. You'd be surprised to know, you know, the procedure was by postal ballot. If I'm posted in, say, Shillong, then, or say in Leh, then I have to, my ballot paper would send the returning officer to the headquarters, the military headquarters in Delhi. The headquarters would actually ascertain where a particular officer was posted or a jawan was posted, and thereafter to his regiment that a ballot paper would go. The resume would then further post it to wherever the officer was, ahead with his company or troop, wherever he's. Now, this entire process of sending the ballot paper from the returning officer to that particular jawan or officer and its return back to the returning officer would not happen within 14 days because 14 days was the only time limit within which this ballot paper had to be returned. Because the ballot paper, the returning officer would issue these ballot papers only after the last date of withdrawal of the nomination. And it has to be back within the 14 days. This would not happen because I myself, this is a petition which I raised, I petitioned the Supreme Court, and the heading of the title is Neela Gokhale v. Supreme of India, wherein I myself sent a representation to the ministry, the election commission, and I still in the ministry after 3 months. This is a very light example. The Supreme Court took up the matter, and in 2014, the election commission actually undertook to commence the e-voting mechanism for the first time in the country. It was because of this petition, and which has ensured that in the 2014 election, it enabled almost 90% of the voters to effectively cast their votes and be counted. Like I said, I'm happy to share that this is my petition, and this order has come in my petition. Then only last year, the Supreme Court was called upon to decide whether access to internet facilities is violative of the Constitution and whether the same are fundamental rights. The genesis of this issue started with a security advisory issued by the Civil Secretariat of the Home Department of the Government of Jammu and Kashmir, advising the tourists and the Amarnath Yatris to curtail their stay and make arrangements for their return in the interest of safety and security. This was when the 370 was, the 376 was withdrawn. Status of the state of Jammu and Kashmir was withdrawn. Subsequently, educational institutions and offices were also ordered to remain shut until further orders. All this was done in the name of security. Obviously, nobody is doubting the necessity of maintaining security of the state. But on 4th of August 2019, mobile phone networks, internet services, landline connectivity, all were discontinued in the valley, with restrictions on movement also being imposed in certain areas. Now, aggrieved by this, one Ms. Anuradha Basin, she was the editor of one daily newspapers in Kashmir, approached the court, Supreme Court under Article 32. And what were her prayers? One of her prayers was issuance of a writ, direction to the Union of India, under which any and all modes of communications, including internet, mobile, and fixed line telecommunication services, were shut down or suspended or in any way made inaccessible or unavailable in any locality. She also sought a writ to immediately restore all modes of communication, including all these internet facilities. The issues before the Supreme Court in this petition was whether the freedom of speech and expression and freedom to practice any profession or to carry on any occupation or trade or business over the internet is part of the fundamental rights under Part 3. And second issue was whether the government's action of prohibiting internet facilities was valid. It was a very, very important, crucial balancing act which had to be played by the Supreme Court. But ultimately, the Supreme Court declared that the freedom of speech and expression and freedom to practice any profession or carry on any trade, business or occupation over the medium of internet enjoys constitutional protection under Article 19. And the restriction upon such fundamental rights should be only in consonance with the mandate of the Constitution, inclusive of the test of proportionality. So there has to be a balance. Simply, you cannot say 144 has been imposed here indefinitely. Internet services banned indefinitely. This cannot be done. The test of proportionality, balancing of security necessities over the freedom of speech and expression have to be seen by the state only then after recording its views, after recording specific reasons and the time of such restrictions, only then this could be done. So basically and in effect, the Supreme Court declared that access to internet is a fundamental right. It's part of the fundamental right under 19 and 21. The Supreme Court is recently also hearing a plea that has been raised the issue of alleged inaction by governments in appointing the president, members and staff in district and state consumer dispute commissions, and lack of infrastructure. You know, the new Consumer Protection Act has been notified in the year 2019, effect from 2020 March. Now, what has happened, what the Supreme Court, very important point the Supreme Court has raised, yes, you have made these acts. Yes, you have made security, Food Security Act. You have made Right to Education Act. You have passed all these legislations. But where is the impact, where is the assessment impact report? Have you actually analyzed what is the impact? You have made provisions. You have made provisions for tribunals. You have made provisions for certain infrastructure. You have made provisions for online filing. But where is the infrastructure? Have you also catered for this infrastructure? And this is what precisely the Supreme Court is actually considering, and the matter is pending before the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court has sought for details, for comments from all the state governments, all the consumer commissions from the districts, from the states, and also the National Consumer Commission. And this is pending. I'm also part of that, representing again the Union of India. Then again, you have the right declaration of right to privacy, which is an offshoot of the alleged, of the challenge to the Aadhaar Act, as we all know. The striking down of adultery as an offense under the Indian Penal Code. They are all shining examples and implied declarations by the constitutional courts that constitutional freedom ought not to be inhibited by the diktat of social norms or popular morality. Independent judiciary thus, through its pen, has delivered the necessary push to act as an agent of social change. And this push actually has greased the wheels of evolution and social justice. A loud and clear declaration has been given. Legislative sanction cannot be used to enforce majoritarian morality. To conclude, I think now we must give way to a discussion wherein there's a question and answer, or, you know, discuss these things in detail. So just to conclude my short few words, all I can say is independence of judiciary and the sovereignty of India's parliament can and must coexist. Independence of judiciary is an important basic structure of the constitution. To strengthen it, it is not necessary to weaken the parliamentary sovereignty, which is not only an essential basic structure, but that itself is a soul of democracy. They have to work, they have to coexist. No one person can actually take away the or trample on the powers vested with the other organ. As far as the fate of independent judiciary is concerned, it's up to us, you and me. You, as future parliamentarians, judges, your vice chancellor has just said, all the law students, all of you are potential parliamentarians, potential judges, lawyers, citizens, and it's up to us to ensure that the goal and object set up by the Constitution, given by us to ourselves, as we, the people of this great country, to write the course of its destiny. With this, I conclude my short lecture on the subject and invite a discussion.
Yes, ma'am. Can you hear me, ma'am?
I can hear you. I can hear you.
What are the threats to Indian judiciary at this juncture? Any threats?
Like I said, threats are there. Threats are many. Obviously, you see every day the Supreme Court or any high court passes an order, it's widely criticized. It's criticized on Twitter, on social media, on Instagram. You have memes. You have various Twitter warriors or, you know, WhatsApp warriors criticizing the judiciary. It can have an effect on the mind of a judge, particularly when he is expected to rule or pass any pronouncement without fear or favor. It's obvious. We are all humans. And this criticism is not from outside only, ma'am. It's from within our organization, within our fraternity as well. And I cannot say that this criticism is actually completely wrong. There are times, there are views which are taken by the constitutional courts, which also are, you know, which trample upon the independence of the state. In fact, this is my personal opinion, and of course, everybody is entitled to have their opinion on this. This watch kept on the government, whatever policy they make, every policy, you know, it does not need to be magnified and, you know, seen under a magnifying glass by the constitutional courts. I feel that the government also has to be left to frame policies. The work of policy making essentially is within the scope and ambit of government powers. So I think the state needs to be given some leash, some leeway to actually do its job And thereafter, the courts can come into play if at all the policy or whatever law is passed is actually not constitutional. So the courts must also realize their limitations, their restrictions, and yes. It's only if these things happen, then there can be a harmony of organs.
Thank you, ma'am. Yes, the floor is open. Any questions from anybody, please? Students, teachers, faculty members, principals, anything, please?
No, one second. Yes, Mitulji, first of all, I would like to compliment Neelaji for outstanding, oration and enlightening all of us. Yes, I have a small submission, Neelaji, and I am sure that everybody would like to know that while comparing the judicial system of other nations, especially developed nations, where we stand with respect to its independent judicial system. So how to assess, how to, draw parallels or make your own assessment while talking about independence of judiciary and its fate. So as Mridulji asked that what are the threats, you have explained very well. But what is the overall scenario, how to make an overview with respect to our position in global setup, please?
Yeah, it is, I think, very, very interesting, and I didn't even dream of answering such a question. But in my study, actually, I had about four or five years ago, filed a petition in the Supreme Court. Again, I said, sort of a activism on my part. You see, in our parliament, in our constitution, or in our system of parliamentary democracy, we don't have yet a codified law to classify offenses by member of parliaments, which are within the parliament and which are outside the parliament. As far as British laws are concerned, we have actually adopted the constitution from all these countries. Mm-hmm. But those countries have moved on and have removed, they have codified these enactments. But we still don't have these enactments. For example, another example I can give you is that they have removed this, like when I said that women entry into the armed forces, the other courts have actually gone beyond, and all their troops are also now allowed entry in the armed forces. But we are into 2021, the Supreme Court of India had to pass that order. It's sort of we have a long way to go. I admit we have a long way to go. But if you actually compare what is there in other states, in fact, there is a petition which my daughter has filed in regard to save your siblings. There is a concept where a person donates, IVF facility is used to actually engineer an embryo without a particular disease and donate it. And just for the purpose of saving one child who is suffering from an ailment, a birth is given to the other child. And her organs and her bone marrow or something is donated. Now, this concept has been actually dealt with by foreign courts long ago. And we have still not actually even touched upon that. My petition, believe me, I filed in November 2020. It's not even been listed today. So we have a long way to go. They are much more advanced, the developed countries. But then we cannot actually browbeat ourselves on this because they have always had a head start. And look at our democracy, look at our population, look at the size of the country, size and diverse religions, diverse communities. So to take all of them together and move on, it's a very, very difficult task. And I believe that we have actually done quite well for ourselves. And if you see the state in other countries is not also very, very great that we need to always pound ourselves and say, oh, we are lagging behind. But yes, as you rightly pointed out, we do need to pull up our socks, and actually we have to do that last mile sprint if we have to keep up with other countries.
Thank you very much. Mridulji, may invite our participants.
Any other questions, please? And students, come on. Any other questions?
Ma'am, I have a question.
Yes,
Aditya. Am I audible?
Yes, Aditya.
Ma'am, as you very greatly explained the judicial intervention in which basically helped our democracy to grow and hold executive accountable. But ma'am, could you highlight some major occasions, specifically in recent times, where judiciary could not do its bit as it used to do previously, and how the judicial activism has progressed down the years? And like, for example, in how Supreme Court has shied away from implementing SR Bhumai judgment's recommendation for appointing chief minister, though they for them, the panacea for all such cases is a flow test, but that is not preventing anything. Neither they have the shadow district implemented Rameshwar Prasad Bihar case, or even ma'am Justice Puttuswamy case of right to privacy. Yes, in the words, it's a great judgment and a new fundamental right has been introduced. But ma'am, down the line, for example, as you spoke about Sushant Singh Rajput case, ma'am, how WhatsApp chats have been leaked through various sources on media, and that's a direct violation of right to privacy. So ma'am, we have great judgments, Supreme Court comes to the rescue, but where is the implementation of it? Where is the concrete effect on the ground? And that's right. My submission.
Yes, you are right, Aditya, and that's a very, very sad thing which we have to admit, that it does exist. There are all these judgments. Some of the judgments remain on paper. And one very classic example is that of, you know, the disqualification case of when in Goa, we have a speaker's case wherein the disqualification petition has not been decided yet. In fact, Justice Nariman, if you remember the Manipur case, wherein Justice Nariman has already given a finding that the speaker has to decide the disqualification whenever a petition has been filed within a period of 3 months. Because otherwise, if the general law is that the constitution bars any direction to the speaker, right? The speaker is immune from any judicial intervention or judicial review. But then if the speaker sits on the disqualification petition, what do? The tenure of the government is over, and then yet that a petition has not been decided. Now, despite that, so many states, there was in fact your own state, look at the petition which was pending, and then ultimately there was nothing to be done. It became infructuous. So you are right, Aditya, implementation is a major issue. We have been grappling with that issue for a very, very long time. The Supreme Court and the High Courts and all the lower courts are also grappling with this issue. But it's very unfortunate, but true. We have still not actually found the means wherein implementation can be, expedited, and whatever has been given by the Supreme Court. Now there's this case, for example, the one which I told you, the Consumer Commission appointments, the Supreme Court is actually hearing it on a very, very regular basis. There is the action, you know, it's all on paper. We'll do this, we'll do that. In fact, even this COVID cases, wherein so many directions and orders are being passed by all the high courts. And actually, in my personal view, the courts ought not to have gotten into, you know, let the governments take a overview and deal with it. But the emergency was so high, that the courts probably thought it best to intervene. But then they're also on paper. So what do you do? It's a major issue. I agree with you. It's a major issue. And there's no quick answer to it.
Ma'am, I have just one last question.
Yes.
Ma'am, though, ma'am, I am in favor of abrogation of Article 370, but the ma'am, the way it was done by using the C70 itself to abrogate it, do you think it is a colorable legislation? Because what cannot be done directly must not be done indirectly.
Pending, it should be decided soon, but it's pending in the Supreme Court. I think it's very premature for us to be actually contemplate what the fate would be. You're right, but you're right though that the way in which it was done, probably there was no legislative assembly, and the constitution does provide that the legislative assembly has to, you know, take it up also. So yes, but let's see what happens. It's sub judice.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. That's all.
Is anybody else, please?
May I ask, ma'am? This is
Deeksha Sharma.
Yes, Deeksha.
Namaskar, ma'am. I am Deeksha Sharma, Assistant Professor of Law. So it is a question. First of all, thank you so much, ma'am, for sharing so much of information about judiciary, various judgments. It was definitely enriching. I have a question reflecting upon the topic of today's lecture regarding the role of judiciary in current circumstances. And when we talk about current circumstances, we are definitely talking about the COVID situations. So what I want to ask, not just from you, from everybody, we have a lot of intellectuals sitting here in this house, and also the students who are very creative in their thought process. This is from everyone. why judiciary, which we are, you know, we are focusing so much, we are very much obsessed about independence of judiciary, so much so that we are making it the most undemocratic organ of the government, right? Apart from legislature, executive, judiciary, if we understand judiciary in the name of independence, we are accepting its undemocratic nature of this particular constitutional institution. Having said that, the problem right now with the judiciary, you know, I find, and why it is so, that the judiciary has to come up with the hindsight wisdom, right? It is as responsible as any other organ of the government in the current circumstances. And when it is criticizing and kind of giving directions to different governments, various high courts giving directions to various state governments, Supreme Court giving directions to Union of India and everything, kind of in the name of judicial activism, you know, it is kind of overreaching to the boundaries of executive and giving a hindsight wisdom. Rather, can't it be, you know, if you are criticizing the election commission, which is again a constitutional body, are criticizing election commission for conducting elections, couldn't the judiciary be more active while the elections were being conducted, while the notification for the election was being there? So criticizing at this point and marking its existence in the Indian political system at this point where everything is already done, how far it is credible for the institution at this point? Point one. So this is one question. Another question, judiciary in the name of independence.
Let's go step by step. So let me answer this first, because then I would just, my train of thought would just go away. Ma'am, you are absolutely right. In fact, if you remember, Mr. Arun Jaitley, who was a parliamentarian himself, said, this is nothing but the tyranny of the unelected. You remember in his book, in his famous book, this was a sentence when he was talking about the judiciary, the overactivism of judiciary. That time he said this, that this is the tyranny of the unelected. And you're absolutely right. When in fact Kumbh Mela was happening, that time with the Uttarakhand High Court, I'm extremely, this is my personal view, obviously please understand this, my personal view, the Uttarakhand High Court ought to have Suomoto and taken this case up and said that put a stop to this. Why wait till the entire exercise has happened? All these hoardings over there, government inviting people to go and attend that, participate in the Mahakumbh Mela, etc., etc. And then after all is done and dusted, then come and say that, oh, what was the state of Uttarakhand doing? That was a completely, completely, you know, a what exercise, if I may say so, without, you know, offending the judiciary in any aspect. But I feel what you say is absolutely right. When it was happening, they should have said this. In fact, Justice Chandrachud, when this the election commission had approached the Supreme Court against the Madras High Court order, when they called the election commission as murderers, this is very, very off the cuff and very unnecessary remark. You know, it demeans and it actually humiliates it's a constitutional institution, the election commission. It also cannot be, I'm sure they had considered various things, or they may have been wrong in doing it. But then to criticize them like that and say that they're murderers was completely uncalled for. I agree with you completely. So, that's the way it is. That's the way it has happened. So it's up to you and me. How many of us went in the Suomoto petition, Suomoto litigation? One of us could have gone and filed a petition in the Uttarakhand High Court, or where the election rallies were held, but we didn't do it as well. So it's a collective error. It's a collective, you know, on hindsight, we see that we should have done that. We should have done this. We didn't. And that's why you're here today. Diksha?
Definitely, ma'am. Thank you for this input of yours as well. So that takes me to another idea that I want to put up here is, do we really need to put the institution of judiciary to that, step of, to that, you know, tower of reverence? That, oh, you are the saviors of us, and you know, whatever you say is going to be the words of the God, without attaching any kind of accountability to them. Is it right to do that? The approach that we have is like a common law approach, what the Britishers used to do, right? So how far currently it is relevant to consider the institution of judiciary and judges as well, with all due respect, to consider them as the most revered institution of the democracy?
Yes, actually, you're right. We do put them on a pedestal, which we shouldn't do. It's not as if it's such a reverent institution. It's a part of the organ in a constitutional democracy. So it has to be given that importance. But then again, you look at the other side. If a particular elected majority government of the state, say, fails to do something, or repeatedly, after repeated representations, it does not act, and that inaction is causing a lot of damage to something, then is it that the other institution of the wing of the organ of democracy becomes a silent spectator to all this? No. So then there's a balance which has to be drawn. So that balance, if every organ of the state does its job properly, then this particular thing would not arise. But fact is that we are also responsible. How many of us go and vote, ma'am? How many of us go and vote? We don't. We say that kya karna hai, right? There is a nota. There is a nota button, right? The will of the people, which we say makes the parliament, right? So it's 100% will which has to be reflected in the parliament. But today it's only 30%. Why? Because only the statistics, if you go to the statistics, only 60% of the population has voted. And in that 60%, these people, the elected government has got 31%. So the 31% are supposed to be reflecting the will of the entire 100% population. So what do we do? You know, this is what the citizens, you and I, students, law professors, and all of us, ordinary citizens as well, need to think. We need a hard look. You know, why are we? Okay, you just, the first question you asked me about the rallies being happened, the Mahakumbh Mela, all these gatherings and marriages and all that. Why does Mr. Modi have to come and, brandish a baton and say, don't do this, don't do that? Why can't we decide? Don't we know what's good for us? Do we have to go and participate in weddings? Why does there have to be enforcement of lockdown, police with dandas? Do we really need that? You know, so we need to take a hard look at ourselves as citizens of this country, and thereupon, then everything will probably fall into place. But then we need to have a social engineering all our moralities. How many you are seeing every day on television? Then how many forged and all these cheating thing is going on? Medicines are there's water in injections and falana and black marketing in holding. Who's doing it? Is the government doing it? Is the judiciary doing it? It's people on the ground who are doing it. What do we do? No, the moralistic views, the social engineering in thoughts and in the behavioral pattern has to change from down there. The government is elected of the people by the people. So they are also representing the sample which is representing over there. It's from us. The judges which are there are from us, isn't it? So I do agree with you here. Yes, we cannot put anybody, any organ of the state on a pedestal, but ultimately then somebody's got to do something, right? That's my view personally.
And thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you.
Anybody else, please?
Yes, ma'am. May I ask a question, ma'am?
Yes, Disha.
Yes. Good morning, ma'am. First of all, I'd like to thank that this lecture is very informative and full of knowledge.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. My question is that we can see today, in today's present situation, there is lots of interference of media in judicial system. So due to that, there is a disturbance in the judiciary system, and the media sometimes play a positive role and a negative role. But due to the negative role, we can see it's an effect on the judicial system. So can there be a effective provisions or legislative system for non-interference of media in the judicial system?
Disha, this is the media. There are these NBC, the News Broadcast Association, and all these corporations which have their rules, and whichever media house or the print media or the television media are affiliated to a particular broadcasting association, they have their own regulations. So like I said, regulation by the government is definitely going to be counterproductive. So media generally follows a self-regulatory system. But it's up to them. Eventually, it's up to them. They cannot be, now tomorrow, if the Supreme Court comes and says, oh, ban the media from saying this, ban the social media. Then again, there's a section of a population, including us, which say, oh, this is a violation of freedom of speech. So everybody has got to act actually responsibly. Now, having said that, what you say, your fear is a little bit unfounded. Because the most of the constitutional courts, barring a few, of course, individual persons, generally I don't get affected by, you know, the popular whatever is there on the media and criticism and all that. They have to deal with all these sorts of criticism, wherein a judge cannot from the bench actually criticize the media. And it is only a one way. They only have to take the bullets and comments under the criticism under the belt. So it's a very, very hard and long task for them also. So I think most of them are doing very well and avoiding getting swayed and influenced by whatever has been put out there in the media and the social media and all the WhatsApp warriors. And I think that fear is there, but it's a little, most of the judges of this country are the bestest of the chief justice are sitting in the Supreme Court. You know, so I don't think we have to fear much about that.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Yes, anybody else, please?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, Dr. Sanjula Thanvi, I want to ask.
Yes, Sanjula, come up.
Namaskar, ma'am. Mm-hmm. Ma'am, I just want to ask that at lower level, we have reservations of women in judiciary as well as in 73rd Amendment. We have in Panchayati Raj also. But at a higher level, we are lacking of this. We don't have women in parliaments, not much sufficient. And also in Supreme Courts and High Courts also. Ma'am, is there any way we can have adequate...
We all petition the courts and say that appoint us, but they're not bound to. This is in a lighter vein, but it's a very serious issue, which needs to be addressed by us. We need to actually gear up, and we have to walk the extra mile, because there's no other way. If we don't fight for our rights, nobody's going to give us anything on the plates anywhere. So we have to actually gear up for a very, very long fight. And I believe the current winds, the way winds are blowing with the current Chief Justice also and all the other judges in the Collegium and everywhere, I'm sure that as far as the Supreme Court is concerned, of course, this has been in discussion for a long time. And as far as Parliament is concerned, there is 33% reservation, and then we must actually take part into it and assert ourselves. There is nothing we can actually do. Except pick up the baton and work at it.
Thank you, ma'am. Anybody else, please? Students? I think there is nobody, ma'am. No. So.
I hope they were engrossed also, and they were able to, they found it appropriate, the lecture.
I think, ma'am, one session with you is not enough. We will have to reach out to you in the future also for your glorious help and guidance to our students, to shape them as strong lawyers and more than that, a perfect human being. This is the only combination which will make this world a better place to live in, I think. And secondly, ma'am, you come from a family of law jurists and likely to achieve greater heights too in professional career. We wish you all the best, ma'am. Now we have our registrar, Sir Shri Raj Narayan Sharma ji, with us, a man who has always guided us in difficult times and extended unending support in completion of work. May I request you, Sir Rajnarayan, sir, to please deliver a formal vote of thanks. Registrar, sir.
Sir, your voice is not coming.
He's not here?
No, he is available, but sir, ki awaaz nahi aa
raha. Main bolti hoon.
Yes, I have opened the speaker. Yeah. Okay. Sir, with your permission.
Sir, sir, ki awaaz nahi aa rahi. seems to be some internet issue at his end.
So am I audible, sir?
Now you're audible. Now you're audible.
Can you hear me, sir?
Yes.
Am I audible,
yes.
Sir?
Go ahead, sir. Go ahead.
Now it's clear, please.
Sir, I'm audible or not?
Yes.
Can I speak, sir?
Yes, sir. Please go ahead.
Okay. Sir, with due permission, ma'am, I was not audible in opening session. So first of all, I welcome you from deep of my heart. And our honorable sir always guide us. And really, this credit goes to our honorable VC sir, that in such crucial and ideal times, he has put a relevant issue for discussion. So it was really panoramic and elaborating session. We are really benefited. We all participants, our ma'am, Mridul ma'am, Deepak sir, our principals from affiliated colleges. So we all are benefited with this issue. Ma'am, right now I'm doing my duties, administrative duties, special duties at Junjunu. So I'm lucky enough to join this session. So I give really thanks from our team that you came and we listened you carefully. So we all are thankful to you, grateful to you. And we always want that these type of sessions should be continued online if the situations are not favorable. So again, I thank all of you, sir.
And at the end, I would like to thank all my colleagues, all the students, all the teachers, principals of various colleges, our special efforts of Mridulji, and at the end, no words to say enough thanks to Neelaji. She's a very versatile person, very talented lawyer, and she's always with us. And Neelaji, once situation becomes normal, we will request you to kindly visit Jaipur also and address our students and faculty. And today's session was fabulous, very enlightening, because you gave lot of insight on various issues, various judgments, judiciary's perspective, your own views also. So it's a complete kind of orientation for all of us to keep us engaged and to think on all such issues. And I'm sure that it's very enriching experience for our students as well, because they are in the process of learning and aspiring jurists of the future. So with this, I request Mridulji to kindly close the session. And once again, enormous thanks from my side. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Neelaji, for this informative and lightning session. As I told you, that one session is not enough. We have to reach out to you again. So request you to help us students also in this. Because they want to be a strong lawyer, we have to shape them accordingly, and we need your help in that.
Anytime, I'm always available for you. Always available.
And with the help of Neelaji, we will request some eminent jurists also to kindly help us in delivering such talks on different issues.
Absolutely.
So take your help for that.
Absolutely.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
With this, I'm closing this session. Thank you, everyone, for participating.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Bye.